In a hydrogen atom, only the principal quantum number, n, affects an orbital's energy. The lower its value, the lower the energy. Using n equals 3 as an example, the 3s, 3p, and 3d orbitals are degenerate, meaning they possess the same energy. However, in systems with more than one electron, these orbitals are no longer degenerate. For a given principal quantum number, the lower the azimuthal quantum number, the lower the energy. Therefore, the 3s orbital is lower than the 3p orbital, which in turn are lower than the 3d orbitals. The magnetic quantum number has no role in the energetic ordering. The azimuthal quantum number becomes so important that Klitschkowski's rule states that the energetic ordering is given by the sum of the principal and azimuthal quantum numbers, or n plus l. The lower the sum, the lower the energy. If the sum is equal, the orbital with the lower value of n is lower in energy. The energetic ordering of atomic orbitals is thus given by the following. In an atom with more than one electron, the optimal placement of electrons in orbitals so as to obtain the lowest energy is called its ground state configuration. The off-Bohr principle states that we start at the bottom and get the ground state configuration of an element by adding one electron to the ground state configuration of the preceding element. At first glance, we might just want to continually dump electrons one after another into the lowest energy orbital, the 1s orbital. However, we must respect the Pauli exclusion principle, which states that an atom cannot have any two electrons with the same set of quantum numbers. Each electron must have a unique set. In other words, an atomic orbital can have at most two electrons in it, one spin up and the other spin down. We recall that all 3p orbitals are degenerate, as are all 5d orbitals, as are all 7f orbitals, and so on. Also, spin up and spin down electrons are degenerate in the absence of any other factors. Therefore, which specific orbital we first occupy and which spin we assign is completely arbitrary. We now proceed to define the ground state electronic configurations of the atoms. For the hydrogen atom, we place a spin-up electron in the 1s orbital. For helium, we build upon this and place another electron in the 1s orbital, but it must be spinned down. For lithium, the third electron cannot enter the 1s orbital, and we must therefore proceed to the 2s orbital and place a third electron spin-up. For beryllium, the next electron can go spin down into the 2s orbital. For boron, the 1s and 2s are now full. We move on to a 2p orbital and place the fifth electron spin up. For carbon, the sixth electron might seem to have three reasonable choices. Spin down in the already occupied 2p orbital, spin down in another 2p orbital, or spin up in another 2p orbital. Hund's rule states that whenever possible with degenerate orbitals, we maximize the number of like spins. Therefore, the third option is the best. The next atom, nitrogen, following Hund's rule, places the next electron spin up in the remaining p orbital. For the next three atoms, oxygen, fluorine, and neon, we sequentially add one spin down electron to each of the 2p orbitals. If we were to continue on to the third period, sodium to argon, we would fill the 3s and 3p orbitals as we did the 2s and 2p orbitals. Finally, the entire periodic table could be done, with d orbitals and f orbitals, following the same principles we just outlined. However, when dealing with transition metals, we often have exceptions. It is not important to memorize them, but it is important to realize that they can exist.